look of the game.
We made it happen today.
Welcome to another round of the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast. Thanks for accessing us however you are doing so, large device or small, audio, video, both, however you wish to download and access us on a weekly basis, bi-weekly basis, daily basis, 2:30 in the morning. You want to listen to us, you dial us up however you do so. John here, Hannah there. Hannah's already got the giggles. And
if y'all are listening to us every day, we have a problem.
No such.
I mean, I know we're amazing, but we're not that great.
Yeah, we are. See, Hannah's already got the giggles. And for this go-around, what we wanted to do was catch up with some friends and kind of see how things are. Because it's old friend, new location. So it might be, what, new job who dis?
Yeah. Yes, exactly, John. It's that time of year with the coaching carousel madness. Mm-hmm. I think you say that 30 to 35% of coaches find new positions each spring. And so we, as always, love to call a few of the friends of the show and see how they're adjusting to their new opportunities.
70 coaches and or openings. There are still a couple of openings as you and I are talking here in mid-April. The openings still?
Mm-hmm. There's any big ones?
I saw that I think Josie had an opening.
Okay.
See, now you're going to have me chase after my list and see if I can find it really quickly. Okay, so openings. So Windsor Forest in the Savannah area. Spalding has an opening. And I know that Lanier County, one of our guests, so there's a tease. Josie, Heritage Conyers. And I think, and that's it, according to our friends at Coach Georgia, by the way, a great Bible for a website. But yeah, just a handful of openings right now. And one of them is one of our guests later in the show.
Any, besides the guests today, any big surprises?
Well,
because one of our guests was a surprise, but then he explains why.
Yeah.
And it makes a lot of sense.
Right. Surprises, I mean, I would look at it this way. One of the trends that we're seeing is involving one of our guests where one of our guests leaves the state of Georgia and goes to a neighboring state.
Yes, that was my surprise. So it was former Brooks County head coach Maurice Freeman.
Mm-hmm.
When I heard he left, I was so shocked because Brooks County loves him.
Mm-hmm.
And he loves Brooks County. But the reason why he left makes a lot of sense. It really has nothing to do with the school or anything that was going on there. But yeah, that was a big one for me.
Yeah, and one of the other elements was the idea that we're now having coaches from the state of Florida come up and be head coaches in the state of Georgia. So that was probably another thing that you're seeing. Camden County, another one of our guests, created an opening, and that created an opportunity for a Florida coach to come into the state of Georgia. So you're continuing to see, like Mike Coe from Coffee was an example of a coach that came from the state of Florida to the state of Georgia. And you're now seeing more and more openings from neighboring states, coaches from neighboring states pursuing openings in the state of Georgia.
It's because Georgia has the best high school football in the country. You really can't argue it. It's really the best.
Yeah,
we
have some of the best
facilities, the best coaches. And, you know, John and I come along with that package.
Yeah, so you got to put up with us as a part of this whole thing. So
amazing. Here's the rundown.
Yeah,
Here's the rundown. We're talking to Coach Freeman. Then we're talking to a new TIFT head coach, Jeff Littleton, and then new Macon County head coach, Kurt Williams, today. So it should be a really good one.
All right. So then do you want to go ahead and toss to our first interview?
Yeah. Let's get Maurice on the phone.
So, obviously, the first question is, how's the Wiregrass been treating you so far? You've gone from Brooks County to Daleville, Alabama, and this was why we wanted to have you on, so we can catch up with you. How's the Wiregrass been?
Well, everything is going well. Hadn't been to Wiregrass yet, but I've been on the road a lot and traveling, and just moved in last night, so I'm at work today and raring to go.
Yeah, Coach Freeman, we caught you fresh in town. You said you just signed your paperwork this morning. What's it been like so far?
Man, it's been mind-boggling. I've not filled out paperwork in 20 daggone years, so feel like a kid, a first day on the job as a kid or something. It's been rough and mind-boggling, all these things you got to fill out and background checks and all this other stuff and insurance. And I'm like, man, I need to call my wife and ask some of this stuff.
So I guess the biggest question for you is why? I mean, you're a Hall of Fame coach here in the state of Georgia, and I know that you're always one to embrace challenges. What was it that attracted you to a job in a neighboring state that is still a drive from home of probably, you know, 125, 150 miles or so? Why do it?
Well, I'll only be driving 125 miles, 150 miles for a couple of weeks, about 6 weeks, and then we'll move to Daleville. My wife will retire in May. I've already retired. I'm 49%, so I've already retired. So it gave us an opportunity to move to another state and get a full salary. So it helps pay bills. It helps you with some of your lifelong goals. It helps us with travel. And they were very interested in what I had to offer and what my wife had to offer. And we, after that, became interested in what they had to offer.
They don't even know what they're getting in, though. They don't even know. You spent 20 years at Brooks County, two state championships in 1994 and 2021. What are some of your fondest memories looking back on that time?
Some of my fondest memories is, probably my most fondest memory would be 94 winning a state title, 2021 winning it again with a guy by the name of Marvin Mitchell, which gave me my first job. And we worked together. We continued to work together. He was sick, had diabetes and a few other things, kidney problems. And winning that second state championship with him when I knew he was in bad shape and he was struggling. And then we lost him that June. That's probably my fondest memory, being on that sideline that last time. And when we realized we were going to win that thing, and that was our first time hugging each other, saying, "Man, I love you, I love you, I love you." I love you too, Coach. Man, you've been great for this county, and we appreciate you coming back. So that one moment there, somebody took a picture of us, and that's one of the pictures in my phone that I'll always cherish.
When it comes to this new challenge that you have, what do you foresee? You know, when you look at the Daleville program and the surrounding areas, you know, what are you looking at for the challenges with this new football program that you're going to be in charge of?
Well, you always want to instill mental and physical toughness, the bring the hammer toughness that we had at Brooks County. The challenge is, can you do that again? Can you bring the hammer to Daleville? Can you get that tough where you play anybody, anytime, anywhere?
Speaking of bringing the hammer, Are you bringing it with you?
I still have the necklace on. You have my bring the hammer necklace on. I still have my bring the hammer brace armbands on, and the hammer is in the truck. They don't know it yet, but I have a brand new hammer in the truck. I'll pull it out soon.
A brand new hammer in the truck.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, so this is going to be fun. Yeah, obviously.
Daleville needs to get ready.
Yeah, they do. Daleville really does need to get ready for this. And I'm looking forward to it because, like I said, I know that you're always one to embrace a challenge in these kinds of situations. But I give you a boatload of credit for doing this at this point of, you know, you're, like I said, you're a Hall of Fame coach. And then you're like, okay, I want to turn left and I want to embrace this new kind of a challenge. I give you all the credit in the world for wanting to do something like this and attacking another program that you feel needs to have the hammer brought to them.
Well, it's always, everybody's great. Everybody coaches really thinks they can coach. Sometimes you have to accept tough assignments to find out what you really are all about. And again, if you're interested in touching kids' lives, then sometimes you got to take a step back and you may end up in a program that's been suffering and has not been as good as it normally is or has suffered for a while. So this is my chance to see what I'm really all about. Do I still have it? Can I bring it to another program? Or are they prepared to accept what I have to offer?
Well, Coach, I think we're going to find out very soon. This fall, what happens? I'm going to miss you so much here in the state of Georgia. We love catching up with you all the time. You're not just a friend of the show. You're a best friend of the show. And we were talking before we went live, and I was like, no. We can't ask him any more questions. We have to save it for the podcast because you're just so special, Coach. And I'm so happy for you. Genuinely, you guys are going to thrive there in Alabama. And honestly, it's the state of Georgia's loss.
Mm-hmm.
So
it
just had to say that.
Absolutely.
Well, you guys are certainly friends. Let me restate that. You guys are family. Oh. Man, y'all my dudes, man. Y'all, man. I always have to take your calls. It's always exciting to hear from you guys, and I enjoy seeing you on a regular basis.
Next up on the list is someone who, as we said, created an opening, and a Florida coach took that gig. And so now we catch up with Jeff Littleton, who has moved on from Bainbridge, gone up the road to a challenging situation at Tift.
Hey, Coach Littleton, you just left Bainbridge, where you spent your entire head coaching career since 2013. You had 5 region titles, 2 state titles. What all went into leaving that behind and heading over to Tift?
Well, got out of my comfort zone, I guess. I'm sitting there with 29 years in thinking about retiring, and then all of a sudden this opportunity comes about, and after some thoughts and prayers and discussions with the family, we decided to jump all in.
And this is a program that over the last handful of years has struggled in Region 1, doesn't matter what classification we're talking about here. I know that you're a coach that, enjoys the idea of chasing after a challenge. You like to be challenged as a head coach. When you look at this program and you're now there at Tift and you are ingrained in it, when you look at the challenges, what challenges do you see in front of you right now that you're trying to tackle before you get into this football season coming up here?
Yeah, I mean, we're in a good area. We're coming in at a good time. I feel like that our weight room was a little behind. Anytime you have a coaching change, there's going to be some things that don't go the way it should. And with the coach stepping out, there was some work not being done in the weight room. So we're a little behind in that area. So we're going to have to catch up fast in the weight room just to be able to compete in this region. It's one of the toughest in the state. And with all the great talent in this area, we're going to have to be able to compete as far as strength wise. Other than that, I mean, I feel like we have good talent here. I'm really pleased with our kids' work ethic right now. I've been here, I'm starting my 7th week here. We have just had a tremendous work ethic. Our leadership, as far as from the superintendent all the way down, has just been phenomenal. And the community been great, welcoming me and my staff and everybody. And I think the whole community and the school system and the players and everybody are just hungry to win. And I think everybody's just getting on board.
You go from 4A to 6A. What are the largest challenges that come with that? Who's the new competition?
Yeah, I mean, just overall from top to bottom, there is no weak team. So we're gonna have a very tough schedule as we had in Bainbridge, and it's gonna be tough week in, week out. So we're gonna have to play very good, very fast. We don't have time to put training wheels on. We've got to jump all in and hopefully compete from the get go. We just want to be able to have a chance in the fourth quarter and then be able to finish some games this year.
I would say, and it's fairly easy to think this, that Tift is one of those, if you want to use the phrase, a sleeping giant. I think when it comes to community, I think when it comes to talent and the level of competition, I think that it's one of those places in the state of Georgia where if you hit it right and you've attention to detail and craft and all these kinds of things, that Tift really can make some noise in Region 1. Has that been part of the conversations that you're getting from the outside, say, when they were trying to have you interested in the job at Tift and what you've been there in the community and seeing? Do they share that same kind of ideal when it comes to, it's like, yeah, if we get a couple of things here, we think that we really can make some noise as a program?
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think it starts with leadership, and you know, Tift County has poured in to their community and reached out to their community, and they have gotten the right people in the leadership areas. We have a new superintendent, we have a new principal, and you know, I just feel like everybody's getting behind these people, and with the right leadership in place, you know, I believe it is a sleeping giant. I believe it's a great place to be, and I'm really excited about the opportunity.
Well, we are super excited to see what happens this fall. So you're little under two hours northeast. Are you settled in? The family all with you? How is all that going?
Yeah, that's a tough one there. My youngest daughter is a junior, so she'll be a senior next year, and she's been in Bainbridge schools since the first grade. So her and my wife will be staying there next year to graduate in Bainbridge, and I think everybody around here understands that, you know. So, you know, that's going to be a tough challenge for our family, but, you know, we'll make it through.
Well, Coach, we are looking forward to seeing how things are there for you in Region 1 as you move from Bainbridge to Tift and take on the challenges there for the Blue Devils. Thanks for hanging out with us here on the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast. We'll be keeping an eye on you, and we'll be catching up with you real soon, especially in season. Thanks for hanging out.
Hey, thanks for having me. Go Big Blue.
And then our third guest this week, really interesting situation. You have a program that really hadn't had a whole lot of success. Kurt Williams comes in his time at Lanier County, takes them into the postseason, gets those wins in the postseason, has a lot of excitement in Lakeland. And so now he moves from Lanier County over to a tremendous Division I, a single-A program in Macon County. So as we transition from Lakeland to Montezuma, here's what it's like for Kurt Williams. And now joining us from, how should we say this? Climate-controlled surroundings in Albany. It's the new head coach at Macon County, Kurt Williams. Coach, thanks for hanging out with us here on the show.
Absolutely. Always a great time to catch up with y'all.
So, obviously, the first question is, you know, what attracted you to going to Macon County after, with everything that you've been doing there in Lakeland and Lanier, with the successes there? You're now the new head coach in Montezuma. What attracted you?
Well, you know, some people know this, but it was actually my first teaching and coaching job was at Macon County. Coach Larry Harold hired me there. I was his first hire in 2012 when it was in his first season as a head coach, and blessed me with a great opportunity and allowed me to do a lot of things that, you know, a lot of head coaches don't let their assistants do. And at that time, Macon County was in a dark time as a football program. They were 1-9, which is kind of hard to believe, but we kind of went in there and rolled our sleeves up, went to work, and was fortunate to coach some really good players. And I think our first year we was able to start a streak that is currently intact. Macon County has made the playoffs 12 straight years now and won a state championship and won a bunch of region championships as well. And Coach Copeland did a tremendous job and just trying to maintain that excellent standard of football we have in Montezuma.
Well, it seems like you did the same thing with Lanier County. So when you took over, the program was 0-10 the first year, and you turned things around, going to back-to-back playoff appearances, winning that first home playoff game ever. That was so exciting. So I know you're looking to propel some of that momentum into your new position. So tell us about how you're getting settled back in and kind of how you can take both of those experiences, building programs back up and then keep pushing Macon County forward.
Well, I think this is kind of unique because, like I said, I was here 10 years ago. So I roll in this time and it's like kids are coming up to me. You coach my uncle, you coach my cousin.
Oh, I love that.
And it's really full circle. And, you know, had an immediate connection with our kids, and our kids we've gotten off to a great start in the weight room and in our off season program, which we're kind of behind obviously with the calendar, but, you know, really pleased with how our kids are working and, you know, just trying to take some of those things you learned as your first time as a head coach and really not trying to rush decisions and trying to get the right people around me. You know, our staff is still under process of getting guys in, and but just really pleased with the support we've got in the first few weeks.
I was going to ask, what's it been like there for you in Montezuma there in Macon County? I mean, it is one of those programs where there is an expectation of getting into the playoffs, deep playoff runs, chasing after championships, those kinds of things. What has it been like for you there in Montezuma, you know, transferring your entire life from basically Lakeland to Montezuma? What's it been like there for you on campus and off there?
It's been awesome. You know, because, like you said, like we're kind of like a South Georgia school stuck in out in the middle of the country. That's kind of like on the border of the Nat line.
I'm actually looking it up right now. I'm like, wait.
John's going to have to come by. It's really not his southern swing. I guess we could be in the middle of Georgia swing, but he's got to make a stop for it.
You do.
And we'll take you out to eat and have a good time. And, but no, it's like, I can't go out to eat without somebody coming up to me and telling me how are we looking this fall and what the expectation is. And, you know, which is great, you know, when you got such a program that the community surrounds and supports on Friday night.
So,
which is kind of a big change, because when I got to Lanier, they love basketball. And we slowly transitioned over time of getting people to love Friday nights because of the success we had. But to be somewhere where they have won multiple state championships and region championships is exciting.
Yeah, have some of that storied history that you can continue to build on. Well, in traffic right now, Lanier County High is, well, your new school, Macon County, is 3 hours south of your old school. Are you settled in? The family all with you? How's all that going?
We are in the process of, let's cross fingers and toes that we are selling our house this week.
There you go.
My wife, Tabitha, and my daughter, Annalise, are back in Lakeland. She's going to finish school out. Okay. And, you know, we are... And I am actually staying with her grandparents, okay, who live off Bridge Road in Macon.
Fun.
Okay.
And it is fun. It is fun. They're really great people. And, you know, that we are close to. So it's about a 45-minute drive from there every morning. You know, and it's hard being away from your family. But at the same time, I do think there is some value of when you transition to have as much time as possible to get your program set up and not necessarily have to worry about when you get home doing my daily duties with Tabitha and taking care of Annalise. So it is very stressful, but exciting all at the same time.
What do you think some of your bigger challenges are when the staff is complete, when you've got all the folks in that you're trying to bring in there? In a region that's got Sly and Marion, and the way things are right now in Region 6A D1, it's Central Tableton, Chatco, Crawford, U, Marion, Sly, and Taylor. What do you think some of the bigger challenges are going to be for you and this first-year staff in that region going up against Darren Alford and everybody down there in Ellaville?
You know, we are graduating some key pieces. We got some key pieces coming back as well. But we're probably going to be more on the younger side in some spots, or at least guys that have not been in key roles that have experience in those roles. And just really trying to catch up our system. You know, they've done a tremendous job here. So it's not like the football program was broke, obviously, coming off an Elite Eight appearance. So we're physically in really good shape already. It's just kind of catching everybody up with our terminology and system and competing at a high level. You know, with the success they've had, your non-region schedule is tough too. We have Bowden and Manchester as well. At home, we play all those guys at home and Sly County. So that we're going to have some exciting games in Montezuma and just trying to get our kids prepared to execute in those big games.
Well, Coach, you have a major challenge this fall, but we cannot wait to see what happens and how it unfolds. Good luck, and thank you so much for joining us today and catching up with us.
Always love coming on with you guys, and go Dawgs.
So, yeah, 70 openings. We still have a couple that are left, and it's interesting on a couple of different fronts because you see coaches that go to take new challenges and to hear Coach Freeman talk about new challenges for a program that was 3-7 the year before, for Coach Littleton to go over challenges that for a program that has only won a handful of games over a couple of seasons. And like I said, I think it's a sleeping giant. If things get on the right track at Tift, Region 1 is going to have somebody else that they're going to have to battle with. And then
Macon County, too. They have region titles, playoff wins, make deep runs. I mean, he could really do some great things there, too.
Yeah, and so really looking forward to seeing how these three, just as a part of the whole process, work their way through and develop. And this is where that, you know, where Kurt was saying that, you know, he's moving family and still trying to assemble a staff. And Coach Littleton is like, okay, we've got our things in place, but, you know, weight room and things like that. All these little things that might be, you know, it's like this piece here, this piece here, this piece here. When all these pieces come together, that's what these coaches are looking forward to. And for Maurice, who's 30 years in and taking a challenge over by Fort Novosel, you know, 4 hours from here, basically, where we're talking, to see him take that kind of a challenge, it's going to be a very, very unique environment across the way.
If I had to put money on if Coach Freeman still has it, I would say yes. He's still got it.
Mm-hmm.
I can't wait to catch up with him. I know he's now Alabama football, but I plan to hope we can still catch up with him this fall and update on what he's doing over there.
Because
I bet it's going to go really well.
Yeah, I think it's going to be interesting to see how things continue to grow with those. So it'll be a fun one.
Yeah.
So what else is on your mind? Oh, yeah, we got to talk taxes.
No, I was hoping you guys forgot.
No, we got to talk taxes, Ambassador Jeremy.
No, this is when everyone can go ahead and your podcast is over. Just click stop and move on with your day.
No,
Hannah, time to move on with your day.
We're recording this on tax day, and you walked in the room scatterbrained because you haven't done your taxes.
Okay, you guys, I have an excuse. We moved to Woodstock. And we lost all of our tax forms in the move. So I had to call Cobb County today. Do you know how much fun that is, calling the county? Do you know how long it took?
Oh, I imagine you were on hold for quite some time.
We just, I'm a mess with these taxes.
Okay.
There's a small chance we pay our taxes today. Otherwise, I will be using the word extension.
Yeah.
And you know, that's okay. It's there for a reason.
Yeah.
Don't judge me.
No judging. No judging at all. None whatsoever.
I'm still a little scatterbrained.
I'm going to judge you in this room over here.
There you go.
So
I hope everybody else got their taxes in. We only have like a few more hours to roll those puppies to the government.
I make sure that other individuals in the house that are far smarter than I am.
Okay, well, I am that individual in my house, John. You know, it's not an easy job.
So you're the smartest person in your house?
My daughters they think they're the smartest people in my house.
But they're the smallest.
They're the smallest, but they think they're the smartest, too. So
I love how she says, think. No, they are. They're the smartest.
They run the house.
They do. So now mine are in. All right. So Ambassador Jeremy, your taxes in?
Oh, they were done in February?
Okay.
Yeah.
And Governor Reagan, your taxes, thumbs up, done. Oh no!
I'm not the only one.
Okay. So that's why we go by code names here, so folks don't get in trouble when it comes to we don't give last names. For folks behind the glass.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll just get completely called out.
Okay. So, well, you're in front of the camera.
I'm uploading documents right now as we speak.
So, Jake the Snake.
No, Jake is out of the room. We got Marky Mark in here.
Okay. So, Marky Mark.
Taxes.
Marky
yes
Mark.
Or no?
Marky Mark. Taxes, yes or no?
Okay,
all right. So,
he's good.
So, Marky Mark, since this
so
is your...
So, the women in the room have not done their
so
taxes.
Since this is your debut, go ahead and swing the microphone over to your position, sir.
Oh, this is a lot of pressure.
It is. It is an absolute lot of pressure.
Wow, you're putting him on the spot.
I am. All right. So All right, so Marky Mark, if you would please, since this is your first appearance here on the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast, if you would please express to folks the importance of this particular day in the day in the calendar, and what taxes mean to you specifically.
God, this is so bad.
What taxes mean and the importance of said taxes as a part of our global structure. Marky Mark's looking at Ambassador Jeremy. He's like, what am I supposed to do?
Mark's very concerned about turning on the mic and speaking.
I thought you were going to have him do what Jake does and give us some football talk.
I'm trying to I'm trying to have Marky Mark give folks a pep talk about doing their taxes.
Yeah, it seems like Mark is the quiet type.
I think you've stunned him, John. No pressure. We do not force people to do anything against their will here.
All right, so fine. Ambassador Jeremy in the role of Jake the Snake,
giving
the importance of some words of wisdom involving the taxes and the tax structure in filling out these paperworks.
Well, I mean, society in general would collapse if people didn't pay their taxes. I mean, it's how we have the things that we have here in the greatest country on the planet. It is how
super smooth streets.
Yes, it's really, how really our society functions. It's how we take care of each other. It's how we, as state employees at GPB, get paid.
Which is somewhat important.
Yes. So, yeah.
So this is where we go.
Maybe you should pay your taxes, Hannah.
So she can pay herself.
We can get paid.
So she can pay herself, yes.
Great.
Yeah.
I'm trying to now. So if we can get off this podcast, we can make this happen.
Fine. I will turn to camera one and go on the ISO here. And that way we can get everything done with the show. So for Marky Mark and his debut, the silent type, for Ambassador Jeremy, for Governor Reagan, and for Hannah, who is feverishly uploading documents to try to figure out what's going on with her taxes here from the past calendar year, I'm just John. Thanks for hanging out with us for another round of the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast. We'll be back a couple of weeks, and we'll talk about more stuff. But it's great to catch up with our friends. Old faces, new places. It's another round of the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast. Play it safe, everybody. We'll see you next time.